was 16 years old, I was traumatized by an encounter with the natural world. All I had ever known was the big city of Los Angeles. I came out of the womb into the city, and I was just surrounded with buildings and concrete and pavement. That's it. And suddenly my mom decided that she was moving our family to what she called the country. I didn't like the idea. I found myself suddenly living in a completely unfamiliar world. My mom planted a garden in our backyard. To that point in my life, I had no familiarity with where food came from. I had only ever seen food come from grocery stores and restaurants. And so, suddenly my mom was growing food, and it was nasty. It didn't taste anything like the food we got from grocery stores and from restaurants. And this piece of property that my mom bought, a house on it, was adjacent to a farm. And so my mom would send me with money over to the farm to buy food that came out of weird places in animals' bodies. And I witnessed where the food was coming from. The milk we would buy, the eggs we would buy. There were aromas on the farm that didn't seem to go with the food that we were going to put in our bodies. And that was the first time as a 16-year-old that I thought, you know what? I think I'm going to become a vegetarian. I don't think I want to eat the food that comes from these places I saw the food coming from. But before you know it, my wife Sue and I were married as teenagers. We got married when we were 18 years old. We got ourselves a piece of property, and we became farmers. A lot of people don't know that about me. I was a farmer. More accurately, our three children were farmers, and we just encouraged them to pick the weeds and to do everything that was necessary to get that food out of the ground. We built a canning apparatus in our front yard. We had 2,000 canning jars. And we took a 55-gallon barrel, and we cut the bottom out, and we lifted it up 12 or 18 inches, and we welded it all the way around so it was watertight. We filled it with water and cut a hole in the bottom of the door underneath, and we started a fire. We could do 24, 26, 28, I can't remember, in the 20s of jars of food. We had 7 greenhouses. We grew tomatoes and made salsa and marinara sauce. And we had 140 fruit trees that were already bearing fruit when we purchased them on a different piece of property. The farmer was going to destroy the orchard and do something else with the property. And so we said, well, could we buy the trees? He said, you can buy the trees. How are we going to get them out of the ground? And we got a bunch of strong, muscular country boys. And we went out with chains and a tractor and a flatbed truck, and we started yanking full-grown fruit trees out of the ground, putting them on the flatbed and taking them to our property and planting them. Of the 140 that we bought for $2 a tree, that was a deal. Of the 140 that we bought and we replanted, we only lost about 20 of them, and the rest of them began bearing fruit. It was a great life. We did the double dig method, French intensive method of bearing fruit. You heard that? This is where you dig with a shovel about 12 inches in to the earth, and you pull the soil out. And then you dig down another 12 to 18 inches, and you loosen it up, and then you put the soil that you took out back in, and it's raised out of the ground because it's aerated. And you end up getting just better produce because the root structures can go deep into the soil that you've loosened up. It was a great life. It was enjoyable to get in touch with the natural world after being raised in Los Angeles. And we did that for years. It was so enjoyable. We began to experience the seasons, the weather, saw how things operate. He saw how things work in the world. We came out, Sue and I came out of the very contrived and false environment of buildings and pavements and machines. And we came in to the country and we began to see how life really operates. We watched that cycle season after season after season, and it was a beautiful thing. But it was more than beautiful, it was educational. We began to notice that things die and then they come back to life again. And we were just in awe of this cycle of life that we were witnessing. Jesus lived and taught in an agrarian culture. He was surrounded with farmers and farms, and agriculture was the thing. He was very familiar with that word that I was very unfamiliar with. And Jesus himself, living in an agrarian culture, was more than just living on the earth around that environment. According to Scripture, you guys, nothing but this. It's man who is now in the flesh, having been God, but we got to return to God, living in this beautiful ebb and flow of other-centered, self-giving love between Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, each one giving to the others and the others receiving, moving in a cycle of giving. On human nature, the one who was now standing on the earth and interacting with us humans. He wasn't merely there on the earth. He was and is the author of that cycle, the author of life. And Jesus, as the author of life, understood and understands the deep inner architecture of life. How it works and how it operates. And in that architecture of life, in the way things are engineered to operate in the natural world, Jesus looked at all of that. He knew we were familiar with it. And then he built a bridge in our understanding between that natural world and the spiritual dimension of reality. In John chapter 12, Jesus comes along and he begins to unpack a kind of theology of architecture, or a theology of agriculture, I should say. So Jesus says in verse 23, track with every word that he says here because this is absolutely brilliant. Jesus says, the hour has come for the Son of Man, that is the title that he used for himself oftentimes. Son of Man simply means I'm one of you. When you hear Jesus referring to himself as, I am the Son of Man, he's saying, I'm one of you. I am a member of the human race. I am a child of humanity. The hour has come for me, the Son of Man, to be glorified. Now, this word glorified is very interesting. It is a Greek word that is very easy to say, to spell, doxa, D-O-X-A, doxa. And it means something like to shine, magnify, or to emit, well, in this context, to emit information, to emit light, to emit truth. The hour has come, Jesus says, for me to be glorified. I'm about to do something that is going to emit light, that is going to unveil truth. I'm about to do something that is going to magnify reality as it really is. So keep watching, because the hour has now come. Now, the hour is his way of referring, as we're about to discover, to the fact that he's about to give his life. He's about to die on the cross. The hour is the hour of his crucifixion that he's referring to. And according to Jesus, when this event some kind of magnifying of reality is going to occur. Some kind of enlargement of our understanding of things is about to occur. I'm going to be glorified, he says. The hour has come. So we're watching now for the magnification. We're watching now for the enlargement of reality and what it is and how it operates. He's about to be exalted in an unprecedented way. And so he explains what this is going to look like. Very truly, I tell you, Jesus says, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains alone. Only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Jesus, in one breath, is talking about his upcoming crucifixion. And in the next sentence, he's talking about agriculture. He's pointing us to the way things operate in the life of the soil. He's saying, listen, you all probably noticed that the only way to get more produce is to give some of it over to death. It has to die in order to be resurrected to new life. The only way to get apples is from apple seeds being planted in the ground and dying and yielding more apples. Jesus is describing the way things work in the world, and he uses very specific language. He says, listen, if you have seed and you just leave it out of the ground, if you have seed and you don't plant it, that seed will remain alone. According to Jesus, alone is bad. Together is good. Alone is an ebbing away of life. Together produces more life. A proliferation of life occurs in the giving of life, Jesus is teaching. So now he's talking about agriculture, but he's also talking about what he's about to do. Because remember our first verse, the hour has come. The point at which I'm going to give my life for the world is up and coming. It's about to happen. And when it happens, there is going to be a magnification in your understanding of the way things really are, the way things really operate. And Jesus doesn't leave us wondering. He explains what he means. Now he's not talking about kernels of wheat. Now he's talking about humans. Any one of you, any one of a human being, well, anyone, any human being who loves their own life will lose it. While anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. That is a profound statement. And it's counterintuitive. We don't naturally think in terms of dying equating to life. Death is death. It's final. It's negative. It's bad. You don't want to die. I don't want to die. But Jesus isn't here talking. Please understand what he's saying and what he's not saying. He's not talking here about merely biological life. He's not talking about dying physically. He's talking about dying on more of a psycho-emotional relational level. He's talking about dying to the ego that would strive to be above others. He's talking about an ego death that will give rise to a different quality of life. Well, that different quality of life that Jesus is pointing us to, he calls here eternal life. Eternal life. Now, eternal life, according to the teachings of Jesus, and I don't have time to pan out far enough to show you this in the text, but I'll just refer you, if you're a note taker, to John chapter 10 and verse 10, where Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly, or life of a higher quality. Or where he said in John chapter 17, a few chapters later, verse 3, Jesus said, I'll tell you what eternal life is. Eternal life is to know me and to know the Father, God who sent me into this world. If you know me, you have eternal life. According to the Bible, think about this for a minute, because according to the Bible, a human being can die biologically in possession of eternal life. Jesus said, anyone who believes in me will never die. And the people he said that to all died. Did he lie? If you believe in me, Peter, James, John, Thomas, if you believe in me, you won't die. And then they all died biologically. But they died biologically with the kernel, the seed of spiritual life intact. And it's that seed of eternal life that they died safely in possession of their mental and emotional faculties, their relational dynamics. They died with the kernel of eternal life in their mental and emotional and relational makeup, so that resurrection can occur. Anybody who dies, listen, anybody who dies biologically, and all of us will die biologically, anybody who dies biologically with love intact in their hearts will be resurrected. This is what Jesus is telling us. This is what he's teaching us. And it's fabulous. Jesus says, if you love your life, this is what is called hyperbole. He's not promoting self-hatred. Jesus is simply creating a hierarchy of value, a value system, we call it sometimes. And that value system is that if I prefer or love my life above your life and well-being, my life ceases to have significance or meaning because it is defined by selfishness. The only life that is viable and can continue on eternally is the self-giving life, because it is self-giving love that is the principle of God's character and the principle of life that Jesus is not only teaching and expounding, but he's about to demonstrate. This love of giving oneself for the good of others is the secret law. This is the thing that Jesus came into the world to teach and to demonstrate by giving his life and then being resurrected from the dead, not by some kind of capricious exercise of power. Jesus wasn't resurrected by a power maneuver. Jesus was resurrected because he died with perfect love intact in his heart for all others. So the principle of life was still alive inside of him in the very act of dying. This is the secret law of the universe. This is the law of reciprocity, reciprocation. This is the law of benevolence. But Jesus explains further. He says, whoever serves me must follow. Now, hold on to that phrase momentarily. What does Jesus mean here? And where I am, my servant also will be. I mean, if you, he's saying to the disciples, those local individuals that he was telling these things to, and down through the corridors of time, he's talking to us, he's saying, listen, you guys are following me. You say I'm your rabbi, I'm your teacher, you're my pupils, you're my proteges, you're my disciples. You've locked into me as the one who is the source of the information that will educate and elevate your life. I'm your master. You're my students. That's the arrangement here, right? And they're all thinking, yup, yup, yup. You're our master, and we're your pupils. And Jesus says, okay, it's not just rhetoric. It's not just words. It's not just theory. I'm not just saying things to. These aren't just ideas. I'm articulating to you what I'm about to demonstrate by giving my life for you. And if you're really going to serve me as my disciples, if you are going to be my servants, if I'm your master, well, you're going to have to follow me. Which raises the question, of course, follow him where exactly? Well, he's setting them up for an amazing epiphany. He's setting them up to understand the secret law of life. He's saying, listen, this isn't merely academic process here. I'm not just telling you information to collect information. I'm not articulating to you something that you might find in a college textbook. I'm describing to you the way life operates. And if you're going to be my disciples, you're going to have to follow me where I'm going. And where is he going? He's going to a voluntary, self-giving act of love that will end his life in favor of the life and well-being of all others. He's going to give the totality of himself. And he's saying, is that what you signed up for? Because that's what I've called you to. I haven't called you to merely memorize doctrinal facts. I'm not here as a theologian. I'm not a professor in a classroom. I am life itself in the flesh. And I'm going to show you what it looks like to really be a human being as human beings were meant to be. Follow him where exactly? Follow him to voluntary actions of self-giving love for others. That's now, he says, continuing on, verses 27 and 28, now my soul, that word is psyche in the Greek, my mind, my soul, my psychological inner workings, now my soul is troubled. He's in turmoil because he sees what's around the corner. The cross is coming up. He knows he's about to be betrayed by one of his disciples. He knows he's about to be forsaken by all of his disciples. He knows that he's about to be led away by religious leaders that have sold their souls for political power. He knows that he's going to be given over to the political powers of the time, the Roman Empire and the Roman judicial system. He knows that he is going to be found guilty and be crucified. So, he's troubled. He doesn't want to experience any of it. And yet he's not resistant to where this is going. Watch this. Now my soul is troubled. But what shall I say? Now he's talking to God. I'm troubled. So should I say, Father, save me from this hour? Is that what I should say? It's a rhetorical question. What's the obvious answer? No. I'm not going to plead my own case. I'm not going to move in the direction of self-preservation. But should I say to the Father, since I'm troubled and I know where this is going, get me out of here. Save me. Save me from this hour of suffering that's about to come. No. It was for this very reason that I came to this hour, Father. Glorify your name. Do you hear what he's saying? He's going through a process in his own thinking. He's saying, should I yield to the impulse of self-preservation, or should I keep on loving them at any cost to myself? That's the question that's on the table. And his answer to his own question is no. No. No what? No, I will not save me at the cost of them. I will give myself for them. And he says, for this very reason I came. For this very reason. To think of the significance of those words. Jesus tells us here explicitly the whole reason for my incarnation and my teachings and my death on the cross. The whole reason for this very reason. For what reason? To show you what it looks like to really love. I'm here for the very reason I have a choice to make, and we are looking into his heart and mind in this process. And the choice is a very simple but profound one. There is, on the one hand, the me. Shall I say, Father, save me from this hour? There's me. Is that the direction I should go? Me, the almighty me? Me, myself, and I, move, follow, or get out of the way? Should I preserve myself and abandon them, or should I abandon myself and hold on to them? This is the question that's on the table. The me versus the you. You guys, this is so remarkable. The God of the universe comes into this world, and he literally was faced with complete personal loss and death. He chooses you over himself. He says, I would prefer my own demise over your demise. Whatever this costs me, I'm willing to pay whatever price is necessary for your life. And if it means my life, I'm willing to give my very life for your life, in exchange for your life, for your eternal life. This is the most beautiful act that has ever occurred in all of human history. This is God being who God is, unfiltered. By unfiltered, I mean without all of the academic lingo of theology and doctrine and creed. Strip away all of religion that has built itself up around the person of Christ. Strip away all of the terminology, the language, and the belief systems, and strip it all away. And at the core of the thing is, I love you more than my own life. That's Christianity in all its purity. That's the thing behind the thing, behind the thing, behind the thing that's under the engine, under the hood, in the deep inner architecture of reality. God loves you more than his own life. That's what's going on in the biblical story. And it's so easy to surround our religious faith with so much language and doctrinal formulations and academic breakdowns that we forget that what we're dealing with is a very personal God that literally loves us more than his own life. That's what's going on in the biblical story. That's the thing that is on display in Christ. So Jesus says, well, then a voice came from heaven. This is the Father. You remember the context here, right? Jesus says, should I say to the Father, Father, save me, 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 me. I'm putting a cartoon here. Me, me, me. What is that? So seagulls and some Finding Nemo. So seagulls. I'm quoting Finding Nemo accidentally. Okay. So me, me, me. Should I save me? Should I save me? And what's his answer? His answer is no. No, I will save them at any cost to myself. Father, glorify your name. Magnify your character in this act that I'm about to perform, this self-giving act that I'm about to perform. Glorify your name. And the Father responds and says, I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. This is extremely beautiful language. This is the Father saying to Jesus, he's saying, well, I've already been glorified in every act of your life. And now I'm about to be glorified again in this consummate crescendo act of self-giving love. I'm about to glorify my name, that is my character, magnify the person that I am. I'm about to reveal to the world who I, God, really am in this act of self-sacrifice that is about to take place at Calvary. And then Jesus says something remarkable. Jesus says something remarkable here. Don't miss it. Now, pause. Now, what is now? Remember our first verse. The hour has come. What is this now? He's referring to the cross of Calvary. I'm about to go to the cross. And now, in that act, now is the time for judgment on this world. Now, the word world is very interesting. It's not a synonym for the earth, for the land under our feet. That's called in the Bible the earth. The world is the systems of interaction between humans that occur on the surface of the earth. The world is a reference to the way things are in human social structures. The marriage structure, the family structure, the governmental structure, the economic structure, the way things operate. The world, think of the world as the world order. The way the world is organized and the way it works, the way we execute existence on planet Earth, the way we do life. Jesus says that when I die on the cross, that entire system is going to be judged. That is to say, when I die on the cross, I'm going to reveal, by contrast, a quality of love that will put to shame this entire self-serving, commodifying, exploitive, oppressive world system that hurts and wounds and takes people down for the count, that creates winners and losers, us and them. Jesus says that entire system of selfishness will be judged when I die on the cross. It will be weighed in the balances of truth and found wanting. The entire system is bankrupt and bogus. It's completely not what God ever intended for human flourishing. So Jesus says, when I die on the cross, the whole damn system will be judged. This is what Jesus is telling us. And he says, now, what is now again? The cross of Calvary, correct? Now, not only will the whole world system be judged, not only that, but the prince of this world will be driven out. Now, in the context of the New Testament, the prince of this world is the illegitimate, usurping prince of this world. He's not referring to himself. Jesus is, in Scripture, the prince of peace, the prince of the covenant of God's love, according to Scripture. But there's some kind of imposter. There's some kind of imposter, some kind of pretender to the throne, some kind of being that is called the prince of this world, but he's occupying that role illegitimately. And Jesus says, not only will the entire world system be weighed in the balances and found wanting, not only will the whole world system be judged by my love in contrast to it, but Satan himself, the devil himself, the author of the selfishness system, will himself be driven out of human affections, driven out of human hearts, driven out of credibility. Let me put it to you this way. The moment you encounter Jesus for all that he is, and you see in him self-sacrificing love as the law of life, the entire world system and the devil that authored it loses credibility in your life. And you begin to say, I know I'm addicted to selfishness just like everybody else, but I'm breaking that addiction. I want to live like Jesus lived. And how did Jesus live? Jesus lived by voluntarily giving himself, dying. The whole world system that we live in is judged by Jesus. And Satan himself has lost all credibility. You could say it this way, quoting Peter, his days are numbered. The devil is roaming around like a roaring lion because he knows that he has a short time. His gig is up. Selfishness doesn't work in the long run. Only love is eternally sustainable. And the cross of Christ proved the eternal sustainability of the principle of love and judged the principle of selfishness. Judgment on this world is one of the things that happened at the cross of Calvary. That's just one of the things that happened. There's other things that happened. By contrast, the world system was judged, but then, and I, when I lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. Please notice the language Jesus chose to employ. Draw. Draw, not push, not force, not coerce, not manipulate. Jesus isn't in the business of shaming us into subjection with religious dogma. Jesus isn't wagging his finger at us with condemnation. Jesus isn't trying to get us to be pretentiously, behaviorally good to get to heaven. Jesus is aiming for our hearts, and so he operates on the principle of attraction, not on the principle of force. The love of God, by its very nature, is non-coercive love. The only relationship that is worth anything at all is a voluntary relationship. We all know this. Nobody wants to be married out of a sense of obligation. You get married because you fall in love. It's a choice. You voluntarily give yourself over to the other as they voluntarily give themselves over to you. No parent wants to raise their child into bondage. No parent wants to be calling their 32-year-old and telling them to brush their teeth or else. You're looking for a relationship where your children grow into your peers. You have eye contact with them. And they're free, and yet they're voluntarily your friends now as adults. Any good parent wants their child to grow up in freedom, not grow up into bondage. A good parent creates necessary space between themselves, their authority, and their child that's growing up. You push the child away from your control so that voluntary love can become the new law between them. And that's what Jesus is doing. He says, when I die on the cross, not only will the whole world be judged, not only will the whole world system be judged, but when I'm lifted up on the cross, you're going to see something extremely attractive. You're going to be drawn voluntarily to me when I die on the cross for you. He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. When I lifted up, he's referring to the fact that he's going to be crucified, and the crowd spoke up. We have heard from the law, that is, the first five books of the Old Testament, the writings of Moses. We have heard from the law that the Messiah will remain forever. In other words, he's saying, what's all this talk about you dying? Kernels of wheat going into the ground and dying and all this. What are you talking about? According to our understanding of the Bible, according to our understanding of the law, well, the Messiah, when the Messiah comes, I mean, if you're him, if you're the Messiah, we've been thinking you're the God. We don't know now because of all this morbid death talk. Well, what do you mean you're going to die? The Messiah is not going to die. That's not how we understand that the whole thing is going to go down. The Messiah will remain forever. So how can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up, that is, crucified, died on the cross? Who is the Son of Man? I mean, if it's not you, who are you talking about? Because we think you're the Messiah, so you can't possibly be talking about yourself as the Son of Man. Do you hear their reasoning? They are mystified by the idea of self-sacrificing love. They want a Messiah with muscle and military prowess. That's what they want. They want a Messiah who's going to kick some Roman hiney. They want a Messiah that's going to marshal an army and begin to destroy the enemies of Israel and exalt Israel to the pinnacle of military and political power. That's the Messiah they want. And Jesus is saying, no, that's not how it's going to go down. Actually, I am the Messiah, and I'm going to die on the cross for you. Then Jesus told them, in response to this illogical reasoning that they think is informed by Scripture, but in fact is not, then Jesus told them, you are going to have the light with you just a little while longer. The light, this is kind of mysterious, symbolic. Walk while you have the light before the darkness overtakes you. Jesus is saying, if you keep thinking the way you're thinking, if you keep wanting a God of power rather than a God of love, the darkness of that thought process is going to overtake your mind. And you will become power mongers yourself if you perceive God only in terms of power. But if you begin to perceive God according to the light that I'm giving you, which is the light of self-giving love, well, then your minds will be liberated. And you will realize that you don't need to conquer anybody for your own triumph. Jesus says, this light that I'm giving you that's about to come to full brilliance at the cross, it's only here for a little while. Walk while you have the light before darkness overtakes you. Whoever walks in the dark does not know where they are going. You are lost in the landscape of reality. You're in psychological darkness. You're in theological darkness. You don't know what you're talking about. You want a kind of Messiah that would just perpetuate the cycle of darkness in the world. If you want a violent Messiah, that will accomplish nothing but more violence. But the light is here. Believe in the light while you have the light, so that you may become children of light. What does it mean to be children of light? Well, the darkness, according to Jesus, is all forms of selfishness. Whether that selfishness takes the form of a self-preserving individual act or a self-preserving corporate act of a nation, the nation of Israel, thinking only in terms of using violence to conquer their Roman captives. Jesus says, no, that's just more of the same. That's just you reflecting back to them what they are. And light is self-giving love. Do you know Wendell Berry? Wendell Berry is such a great American poet. He's from Kentucky. He's a farmer. He's a farmer poet. And he's written some of the best poetry that has come from the American poetry scene. I love this guy so much. He wrote a long poem in the form of a book. You must own this yourself or download the PDF. You have to have this poem just for the title. The title alone is pure brilliance. It's the Mad Farmer Liberation Front. That's Wendell Berry. He believes in a kind of madness that is agriculturally based. He believes, and his poems communicate the idea, that the best way to live is close to the land, growing things, and making salsa. This is the way to really live. Have yourself some guacamole and share it with your neighbors. This is what it really looks like to live. Can some peaches. Can some peaches. Get yourself some applesauce. This is the mad, the crazy, the insane Farmer Liberation Front. He's saying the liberation lies in the direction of people living their lives in agrarian farmer communities where you're trading your broccoli for roses. It's such a beautiful picture of the world. And in this poem, he says something very remarkable. Wendell Berry says, every day do something that won't compute. He means on the economic level. Do you realize that there are things that are more valuable than the monetary value that can be placed on them? There are things that cost $10 that are worth more than $10. And there are things that cost $100 that aren't worth $100. Like a Gucci purse, probably. Something like that. Do they make purses? I don't know. I think they probably do. These things that cost a lot are worth less than things that cost a little. Like two young lovers 18 years old, going through the Taco Bell drive-thru. How amazing. Sitting there eating their burritos together in the parking lot. A total of $12 is spent. And this beautiful conversation over the burritos that is occurring. Who needs a five-star restaurant when you have one? That's what we're very excited about. That's why I like it so much. I want to get Taco Bell. Every day, do something that won't compute. Do something that you can't affix a monetary value to. Right? This is brilliant. Love the Lord. Love the world. Work for nothing. Just do something every day that is not able to have a price tag put on it. I love this. Take all that you have and be poor on purpose, voluntarily. Take everything you have and be poor. I love poverty. Poverty is a great thing as long as you are poor in the American sense. Which is not very poor. Take everything you have and be voluntarily poor. Love, look at this. Love someone who doesn't. What does the word practice mean? It means the habitual application or use of an idea in the form of action. You have something in your head, you have an idea. Act upon it repeatedly, and that's called a practice. Right? Like practicing tennis, practicing your fastball, practicing the piano, doing something over and over again. Practice resurrection. What is resurrection? Resurrection is coming alive from the dead. What does Wendelberry mean when he says practice resurrection? He's saying habitually bring dead things to life by your actions. You see somebody who's sad? Practice resurrection by shooting a smile across the room at them and watch them come alive with a smile that reciprocates your own. You see somebody who's wounded and hurting? Put your hand on their shoulder, give a gentle squeeze, and say, I'm here with you right now. Can we pray together? And watch them just come a little bit more alive by your presence with them in that moment. I see you. I hear you. Can I pray with you? You're giving life. So you are composed of body, brain, and mind. Body is the physical part of me that you see, it's the physical part of you that I see. And in that body of yours, you have one big giant organ that consumes most of the calories and energy in your physical structure, and that is your brain. Your brain is a physical organ. And the physical organ that is your brain generates the non-physical phenomenon of mind, which is composed of many different dimensions, but at bare minimum, thoughts and feelings. And when you have thoughts and feelings in your mind, which are generated by the chemical processes of your body, in your brain, when you have thoughts and feelings, the moment you have a positive thought, it will generate a positive feeling. And the moment you execute an action that harmonizes with that positive feeling and positive thought, you're forming a habit. You're forming If you have a thought which generates a feeling, and you act it out repeatedly, you're becoming a certain kind of person. You're gradually morphing yourself. You're literally a transformer of sorts. You're literally morphing your own being by your actions, which arise from your feelings, which arise from your thoughts. And so, every time a person, and this would be you, me, anyone, anytime you perform an act of love, you are imparting life to another person. An incremental quantity of life and a certain quality. Every time you perform an act of love, you're giving somebody more energy than they had just moments ago. You're giving life to them. A smile imparts life. A gentle handshake imparts life. A $100 bill for somebody who can't pay their rent imparts life. Do you understand what I'm saying? Actions performed repeatedly, right, form identity and character. But there's something else happening. Every time you perform an act of love, not only are you imparting life, not only are you imparting life, you are becoming more alive yourself. So that when you perform an act of love, what Wendell Berry calls practicing resurrection, when you practice the beautiful art of resurrection, when you practice imparting life to others through beautiful acts of kindness and love, every time you impart love to someone else, you are imparting life to them. And simultaneously, you yourself are becoming more alive. It's exciting to love people. I'm going to try to tell you. It's exciting to love people. It's a very good thing to self-assess and say, this is who I am and this is what I have. It's not much. There's the me. There's also the you. And I, in this moment, see you and exist for you. And in existing for you, what did Jesus say would happen? Life comes back to me. Every time I plant seeds of love in the soil of somebody else, part of me dies, Jesus says, only to be resurrected and to be alive on the